when they talk.
Greetings and salutations. On Monday, British Petroleum, the United States Justice Department, and five states announced a $20 billion finalized settlement for the Deepwater Horizon oil spill that took place in the Gulf of Mexico back in 2010. Here is how the settlement breaks down. You have $7.1 billion in natural resources damages claims under the Oil Pollution Act, $5.5 billion to settle civil claims under the Clean Water Act, $4.9 billion in economic damage claims to the five Gulf states, $1 billion previously committed for early restoration, and up to $1 billion for the local governments. Now, hold your applause and leaps of joy, because like all things involving the government and big oil, there appears to be a catch. There is always a catch. Apparently, a very large chunk of what Attorney General Loretta Lynch called the largest settlement with a single entity in U.S. history is a tax write-off. A tax write-off. How much of a chunk? Well, about $15.3 billion, according to the U.S. Public Interest Research Group, or U.S. Purge. Michelle Circa, a program associate with U.S. Purge, states, BP was found to be grossly negligent in the Deepwater Horizon case, and yet the vast majority of what they are paying to make up for their gross negligence is legally considered just business as usual under the tax code, unless the DOJ explicitly prohibits a write-off, which it appears they have not, which is why it is time to start watching the Hawks.
Wanna know what's going on in your city and your streets? Never back down like Tyrell, and the truth is what you seek. To analyze, investigate from the bottom to the top. You speak your mind like Sean Stone, whether they like it or not. I got Tabitha, Miss Wallace, with the wisdom and the pearl. Between the outrage and the evidence, what's going on in this world?
Watching the Hawks, watching the Hawks, watching the Hawks. Listen when they talk.
Welcome, everybody, to Watching the Hawks. I am Tyrel Ventura.
And I am Tabitha Wallace.
Ooh, they're going to kick things off with BP's sort of $20 billion settlement. Wow, tax write-off time. BP just saying, hey, you know, $20 billion, now we're right off 15. Just to give you a breakdown of kind of why they're allowed to do this, Robert Wood of Forbes magazine wrote, the present tax code allows businesses to deduct damages, even punitive damages. Restitution and other remedial payments are also fully deductible. Only certain fines or penalties are non-deductible. Even then, the rules are murky and companies routinely deduct payments unless it is completely clear that they cannot, which is when the Justice Department puts a rider into the settlement saying this is not deductible. But in this case, that is not true.
Well, in any case, it's ridiculous. If your average citizen can't write off their parking ticket, their speeding ticket, if they burn down their neighbor's house and have to pay all the fines, if they're not allowed to write it off, then they shouldn't. Because corporations are people.
Corporations are people. BP is a person, and
right,
it shouldn't have to pay $20 billion altogether.
Which is to show
part of it they do
cuts.
Have to pay, and part of it does actually have that DOJ.
What exactly are the parts that they have to pay?
Well, when you look at it, they have to pay $5.5 billion is the total that is categorized as a civil penalty, which isn't deductible at all.
Well, great. You know,
Attorney General Loretta Lynch identified that as the largest such penalty in the history of environmental law. Very interesting.
That's crazy. There was a quote actually by, you had talked about Michelle Shurka too, about the 5.5 civil penalty. And she had said, being explicit about denying deductions for the Clean Water Act penalty is certainly a step in the right direction, but it's only a small, it's a small one considering that the remaining $15.3 billion is wide open for deductions. The Department of Justice should go further and make sure that the entirety of the settlement is non-deductible, regardless of how the money is spent. And what they had said, like you had said, this sort of tax-deductible elements of being 15.3, what that actually comes out to in the end is a $5.35 billion windfall.
Whoa.
For BP.
Wow.
They've literally just profited from the deep water after everything you go through. This is a major issue. It isn't just about, you know, making corporations pay their taxes. It's about getting a completely different tax code for these corporations, because this is unconscionable. When you have Americans who can barely get by because their property taxes, all these taxes, and it's always got to pay your fair share, you know, you've got to, you know, do your part as an American. They should be doing their part. If you're going to do business here and you're going to pollute here, you should have to pay.
Tell them, this is America. Corporations don't have to pay their fair share because we are dependent on corporations to provide money for lobbyists and to provide money for political campaigns. That is why they can use this now windfall of cash. They, you know, they can put it right back into the political pot, so that way this can keep happening over and over again. But it's interesting because this isn't the first time that they've written something off in the history of dealing with the spill in the Gulf. BP has already written off the cost of its $32 billion cleanup effort after the spill, earning a tax windfall of $10 billion. This is according to the U.S. purge again. And what's really interesting is the federal agencies did not attempt to prevent this give back through the tax system. By contrast, however, the Department of Justice reached a criminal settlement with BP over its role in the deaths of 11 workers who were aboard that oil rig when it exploded. That $4 billion settlement, Tabitha, that was not tax deductible. So the cost of those human lives, not deductible. That should be across the board. That should be across the board with the amount of devastation that spill, and the fact that there were some reports that they even knew that something like that was on the horizon.
Oh, they knew.
That they knew it was coming. Good old Halliburton in there making money actually off the deal, I believe, when it happened.
Yeah. But this is it's unconscionable, and I think that Americans in the next election should really harp on whoever your presidential candidate of choice is to get behind something
and
make these changes, changing
the
tax codes. But that's a story for another day. Mm-hmm. The horrible tragedy which took place on September 11, 2001 has been used to justify every excess of modern American policy, foreign and domestic. Our nation still to this day occupies Afghanistan and has left Iraq a shattered shell of a satellite state, although it is widely known that there was no connection between Saddam Hussein and al-Qaeda at the time of the U.S. invasion. And we're not even mentioning things like the Patriot Act, excessive government spying, and the endless farce that is the war on terror. In a semi-sane world, you might expect U.S. lawmakers to cover their tails and at least make a semi-serious bipartisan effort to care for our wounded soldiers and for the police, firemen and women, and other professionals who dug us out from the rubble, ash, and sorrow of 9/11. But we don't live in that world. We live in a world where on October 1st, Congress failed to extend the James L. Zadroga 9/11 Health and Compensation Act. That's right. The legislation that funds medical care for the over 70,000 first responders who aided in the immediate aftermath of the attacks. Without renewal, funding will expire in September 2016, despite near unanimous support for the funding program from the American people and a high-profile lobbying by John Stewart. So, should we expect Congress to eventually refund the program? Or is this simply the outcome of empire, where destruction abroad is mirrored by the ruin of any moral fiber left in our legislative body?
What really, I think, gets under my skin with this is the fact that every anniversary of 9/11, almost every politician across the board in Congress will parade, you know, our first responders, NYPD, FDNY, out to say, you know, how much they lost and the cost they gave that day, and then to turn around and not give them the benefits that they deserve for being there that day, doing their job and doing, you know, what is called of them without, you know, any doubt, and then going in there and saving lives that day too. Let's not forget how many lives that they saved that day.
Right. I mean, this is in the line of duty. They go into this job knowing that any other person was on a job and was injured and had long-standing effects from that, they would be, any private company would be legally obligated.
Yes.
You could go to court. The idea that any politician, and they should all be ashamed of themselves, it must be Ambien is the only way the politician in this town can sleep at night, because there is no other way you could put your head on your pillow at night and go, it's okay, I just took away health care to first responders from 9/11.
Well, we'll get into the details of this act. It supports, as I said, 70,000 first responders. When you look at the first responders have increased rates of all cancers, particularly lung problems, cardiovascular disease, emphysema, and other neurological issues arising from the debris and smoke that they told us was going to be okay, that they could work there. Remember Bush and the EPA came out out and said, oh, no, it's perfectly safe to be there. It's named after James Zadroga, 9/11 first responder policeman who died of respiratory disease, and there was evidence of glass fiber in his lungs at the time of his death. This breaks my heart.
Yeah.
Breaks my heart. Our politicians don't have the... If you get one thing done,
one.
Congress, one thing, do this.
And let's not forget that this has had a problem since the beginning of this bill. They were already fighting against
true.
It, which is hilarious because they were, you know, everybody, every politician, whenever a microphone was put in front of them at that time, was like, these are heroes. Don't, you know, you're shaming heroes if you're not doing something. These were the same guys who went up. The original bill in 2006 didn't pass, actually. And there was, if you don't remember, there was a huge scandal because Republicans were trying to filibuster it. Then in 2010, it was the same politicians over and over. That was when John Stewart first had come up and gotten it bill pushed through in 2010 for another 5 years. But it's a shame that it has to get to this point. Soldiers, these first responders, they're not politicians. They're not, you know, regular citizens. These are people who walk into the worst of it to save people's lives, and they do it at risk to themselves. And what we owe to them, no matter what our political leanings are, left, right, or center, anywhere, we should be taking care of them.
Most definitely.
That shouldn't even be a
politicians question. Are so quick to put heroes by their sides in order to get elected, but when it comes time to take care of them, they send them down the road. You see they do that with our veterans, and now they're doing it with the first responders from 9/11. Is absolutely disgusting. But let's move on to something that isn't disgusting. Last week, a Michigan soy farmer, James Bristle, made a massive discovery while digging in his field. Massive not only in size, but in its significance to paleontology. What at first seemed to be just a rusted fence post turned out to be the remains of a woolly mammoth. Found was a skull, two tusks, the pelvis, ribs, vertebrae, and the shoulder blades of a woolly mammoth, or Ice Age elephant. The bones are thought to have been stashed there by humans who hunted the animal some 15,000 years ago and would have stored the meat in a pond for use later. Bristle has donated the find to the University of Michigan. Dan Fisher, professor of paleontology and director of the University of Michigan's Museum of Paleontology, says the find is one of the more complete sets of woolly mammoth bones ever to be found in the state, and that it could help shed light on the and when humans arrived in the Americas. However, there is no word yet if lunchboxes bearing the names Fred Flintstone or Barney Rubble have been discovered in the vicinity. As we go to break, Hawk Watchers, don't forget to let us know what you think of the topics we've covered on our Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube pages. Coming up, retired Colonel Lawrence Wilkerson, the former Chief of Staff to Secretary of State Colin Powell, enters the Hawk's Nest to discuss the current situation in Syria and the good and the bad of the Iran nuclear deal. Stay tuned to Watching the Hawks.
Most people think to stand out in this business, you need to be the first one on top of the story or the person with the loudest voice or the biggest ratings. In truth, to stand out in the news business, you just need to ask the right questions and demand the right answers. Question more.
Some people ask more questions than the government wants them to.
How do we make decisions about how we want to vote? How do we make decisions about what kind of government we would like if we don't know what those governments are doing?
They are whistleblowers, and they want to know what is really going on.
It's extremely dangerous in America right now to be right as a whistleblower when the government is so wrong. So speaking truth to power is now a criminal act.
Whistleblowers are growing more dangerous than external threats.
And a dozen agents are streaming across my front door. My life at that point was turned completely upside down.
They are seen as enemies of their own country.
We're at war with a bunch of people who want to hurt the United States of America. And for people to leak that program and for a newspaper to publish it does great harm to the United States of America.
What secrets make a government go to war with whistleblowers?
The U.S. mainstream media has been abuzz recently about Russia's involvement in Syria. Too bad a U.S. airstrike in Afghanistan this week killed tens of doctors and patients at a Doctors Without Borders hospital in Kunduz. Kind of puts a damper on accusing other countries of blatantly targeting civilians. But as the media continues to cover Russian airstrikes, news outlets have failed to account for how Russia's involvement complexifies an already complex geopolitical quagmire. Well, to sort through the implications of Russia's involvement and whether or not the U.S. is serious about defeating ISIS and stabilizing the region, we invited Larry Wilkerson, retired colonel and former chief of staff to Colin Powell, to talk with us. We first asked Colonel Wilkerson what he thought about the Western media's reaction to Russian airstrikes in Syria and whether or not Russia's involvement would, as Western media claims, actively destabilize the country.
That's not my assessment. I pray that Moscow, Washington, Ankara, Tehran, perhaps others are talking right now about how they coordinate their efforts to accomplish what should be all of our first priority, and that is to defeat these forces called Daesh, ISIS, ISIL, and to put everything else aside, as it were, until that is accomplished. That's going to take some time, too. We've now got the possibility for this to spread majorly into Afghanistan, with the Taliban having taken Kunduz, that critical area. The Chinese are already looking at it because it's already doing things in Xinjiang province to disturb their state stability there with the Uyghurs and the revolutionary movement, if you will, that exists there. It's already doing things to destabilize, of course, Afghanistan and the surrounding area. It's concerning Moscow, I'm sure, because that's their soft underbelly there, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and so forth. So this is a problem that could metastasize as cancers want to do and go all kinds of places. And we need to stop it. And we need to stop it like you stop cancer at the point of origin. And the point of origin right now, most prominently, is Syria. All hands should be working on this. I welcome Russia's assistance.
Well, the stance from the United States is that we have to remove Assad from office and drive ISIS from the region at the same time. In your opinion, can Assad be removed and what little stability there is in Syria be maintained without recreating the same quagmires that we saw in Libya, that we see in Iraq?
I think you're right, and I would not prioritize my tasks that way. My first priority would be to defeat ISIS, and I would bring in those who are fighting ISIS and coordinate those actions in order to defeat them. Once that's accomplished, and very solidly accomplished, mind you, not like we did in Libya, where we unveil the largest arms depots in North Africa without leaving anybody to take care of them, to include shoulder-fired missiles and other sophisticated arms. No, in Syria, we should make sure the enemy is defeated, thoroughly defeated, and then and only then should we work on an interim government, probably including President Assad, and a more representative government of the Syrian people, which will probably mean that Assad has to go at some point. But let's prioritize this properly and let's take care of the priorities in order.
Pretty logical thinking. All right, so I have a million-dollar question for you. I think most U.S. citizens and possibly many around the world are really secretly asking themselves is why? Why is the U.S. so concerned about Assad? I understand the concern dealing with ISIS, but why is the U.S. so obsessed, it seems, with Assad and his regime? And why is it in the U.S.'s best interest to even be involved there?
We walked ourselves into this corner with human rights interest, with people like Samantha Power and others in the White House telling President Obama at the time that the Syrian civil war started, and it started over water more than anything else. Not having second year in a row, Syrian farmers, over 200,000 of them, not having water, and people like Samantha Power and others seeing this as an opportunity to unseat Assad, whom they saw as a brutal dictator, and there's some proof of that. But Assad was not Mubarak; that was the template they were using. Mubarak was detested, and he had to go. He was going to go, no matter what the United States did. Assad's not that. He's got quite a power base in the military, in the Alawite community in general, and in the business class in Syria, particularly in Damascus. So he's not going anywhere anytime soon. I said that long ago. We made these stupid statements about him being unacceptable, about his not staying in power and everything, and now we're hoisted on our own petard. We should be big enough to back up from that and say, nope, we were wrong, let's do this differently, let's defeat ISIS, and then we'll work on a more representative Syrian government.
I want to move on to the recent Iran nuclear deal, and what is your opinion on the deal? What are the good points, what are the bad points, what's the most important thing people should know about it?
The first good point is it, if it works, and my Republican Party in particular, and some Democrats are busy like little beavers trying to think up ways in the Congress to derail it even now. But if it works, the biggest thing it does is it prevents the United States from going into another catastrophic military campaign in Southwest Asia. It also prevents Iran from having a nuclear weapon for at least the period of the agreement, and incredibly intrusive inspection to detect if they're cheating and then go back to the military option if that's warranted. So this is a good deal all around. It's a good deal for Iran, too, because President Rouhani got elected primarily based on his promise to the Iranian people to restore the Iranian economy to some sort of prosperity and stability. And he's going to have to spend the majority of the money he's going to get out of this, and he's going to have to use the lifting of the sanctions and the ability to cooperate and to coordinate with the world's business community to resurrect the Iranian economy, or he's not going to get reelected. So this is a win-win for both sides, which both Secretary Kerry and Zarif have said several times. I think they're right. It's a win-win for both sides. That's how you judge diplomacy. You judge diplomacy on whether or not you get up from the table at the end of the negotiations, and both sides do not have everything they wanted, but they do have a victory. And in this case, both sides can say that. So this is good diplomacy.
Some would say that the deal actually makes it easier down the road for the U.S. to justify an attack on Iran if they don't, because now there's specific rules in place, and if military action was needed, it's much more justified, it's much easier to sort of sell on to the international community. Is that a true assessment?
Well, I don't think so at all. I think if Iran is detected cheating, and I put that cheating in open air quotes, then the United States is going to be the intelligence apparatus most likely to do that. I don't think anybody in the world is going to believe us. I think we will be totally isolated. I think we'll be alone, even if it's credible evidence, I think that. And then we're going to have to make some really hard decisions about whether we want to go do another Iraq, that is to say, totally alone, no real allies other than Britain in the case of Iraq, and suffer the consequences. But back up just a moment. And go back to what I said before. This is the most intrusive inspection regime ever put in place on a state. This is a regime that is going to give us probably 12 to 14 months of warning of breakout, rather than the 2 to 3 months we had at the beginning of negotiations. This is a regime that's going to take them from some 19,000 centrifuges down to less than 6,000, and they're the old centrifuges. It's going to destroy the quickest route to a bomb, the plutonium route, by putting cement in the Arak reactor. It's going to do all manner of things that are going to keep the Iranians from making a bomb. Here's my concern with the agreement, and really my only concern. That is, we're going to go 5 to 6 years down the road, and it's going to be working so swimmingly, so well, that Iran's economy will be prospering, everything will be hunky-dory with regard to Iran, we really won't have any problem with a nuclear program, and then someone, the Israelis come to mind immediately, will run a false flag operation, run it up the pole, and the United States will react to it and say, oh my God, they're cheating, now we've got to do something, and the United States will be utterly isolated, alone, but facing a situation that Israel says, at least, and probably our intelligence community will corroborate for whatever reason, political or otherwise, that we have to do something about militarily. That's the thing that troubles me the most.
I can imagine. Now, it's interesting. You've been, you know, an insider in Washington, so I got to ask, from an outsider's perspective, it feels like regardless of the president or the party in charge of Congress, that our basic approach to foreign policy doesn't really change, especially regarding the military and its use overseas. I think many would say that Obama essentially, in a way, continued the Cheney-Rumsfeld kind of doctrine, maybe even escalated in certain areas like drone use. Do you agree with that perspective? And why, you know, is there just not really a change regardless of the party in power?
I agree with that perspective for a number of reasons, and I teach this, so bear with me for an academic discussion. Ever since the 1947 National Security Act, the United States has been in a state-building effort, the purpose of which is to create a national security state. What that means, in short, is the reason for the state's existence is to use the military. There are all kinds of pernicious influences that make this the case in this country now. Everything from the military-industrial complex to the penchant for decision-making inside the White House, minus the cabinet, minus diplomacy, minus economics, minus finance, minus trade. Everything turns to the hard power, to the military. Any president of any type, Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, Donald Trump, God forbid, any president is going to be immediately captured by this apparatus that we've been building since 1945. And it's very difficult to break out of this apparatus, particularly if you don't have much experience with the bureaucracy, and you have to trust people like John Brennan at the CIA and others who are going to tell you what they want you to hear, not necessarily what's true. They tell you what's conducive to this state-building effort, to maintaining this national security state, not what's necessary for U.S. national security interests, necessarily. So this is a very dangerous situation for our republic, an extremely dangerous situation. If we don't have someone soon inside that Oval Office to do something about this, or the American people to do something about this, and I think the latter is probably a better case than having someone in the Oval, we're going to be in real trouble. If nothing else, we're going to bankrupt ourselves.
Wow. Thank you very much, Colonel Lawrence Wilkerson, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. And that is our show for you today. Remember, everyone in this world, we are not told that we are loved enough, and so I tell you all, I love you. I am Tyrel Ventura.
And I am Tabitha Wallace.
And keep on watching the Hawks. Have a great night, everybody.